participate in what's called a call to worship. This calls us into worship. This prepares our hearts and our minds for worshiping God. So we come, for God gathers us here with that community called faith. We come, for God welcomes us here into the home called grace. We come, for God reunites us here, sisters and brothers, in that family called love.
Crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven.
invite you to be in an attitude of prayer.
Bill, and I'm the lead pastor here. I guess I'm the only pastor here right now, but it sounds cool to say lead pastor, doesn't it? So I'd like to tell you that I just walked in this morning. I said, "Man, Britt, I just don't feel like preaching today. So let's switch." And she probably, if I did that, she'd probably say, "Okay, would you?"
Yeah.
Okay, we'll try it next week or the week after or something like that. But we're really blessed to have Britt here. She's our director of communications, and she's being called into ministry. But wait, there's more. Then we got Wesley over there. He's holding up that column so it doesn't fall. He's got the red shirt on. And he's called into ministry as well. So he's looking to go to seminary as, next fall, aren't you? So either Duke or, what's that other place? Candler. Not St. Paul. That's okay. I'm going to hold it against you. There's a couple of announcements that I do want to share with you. Is next week. Next week is the 26th, right?
Yes.
We're having another potluck. All right? So come on. Bring some food. We're going to sit right back there, and we're going to eat food, and then we're going to have a visioning meeting. It's time for us to vision and listen to God and find out what exactly does God want us here at Lynn Memorial to do as a church here on campus, but also off campus. So, and here's the thing, if you don't bring any food, it's a potluck. So it's okay, come anyway and eat with us. If we all have to share one bowl of baked beans, that's fine. That's the nature of a potluck. And the other announcement, I forgot, so it doesn't matter. But I want to emphasize that last week, we started this sermon series called The Four Alls. It's the Methodism's Four Alls of Salvation. And I spoke last week about all need to be saved. And I explained Paul's meaning when he said, "All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Now this sounds like, oh my goodness, am I coming into this church and they're going to tell us how wicked and horrible we are? No, I'm not. I think it's important to look at ourselves like a light bulb, right? So take this light bulb, and we come out of the box with a broken filament. And we don't work too well. And there's something missing. But that brokenness is sin. And we all do it. And we're going to continue to do it. Even after we turn our lives over to Jesus, we're still going to make mistakes. But I say this to offer you encouragement. To let you know it gets better. And there's a way out of this. And if you're like me, or the Apostle Paul for that matter, you may ask yourself from time to time, what on earth is wrong with me? Has anybody ever asked that? Let me see a show of hands. How many of you have not asked, okay, you're not asking Bill and Neil what's wrong with you. How many of you have asked yourself, what is wrong with me? Why do I do these things? Why do I do the things I don't want to do, and then I do the things I want to do? It's because we have this condition, sin. And it's not your fault, okay? I want you to know that it's not your fault. It's not my fault. We're just born into it. Now, we can't thank Adam. It's his fault. If you need a scapegoat, talk to Adam. But there is a solution. And this is the second all, and this is the most exciting point of the day, is that all can be saved. God desires everyone to be saved and come to the knowledge of that truth. The second all is an affirmation of Paul's statement to Timothy that God desires everyone to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. I want you to look at your neighbor and I want you to proclaim, God desires you. A little louder, please. I know God can hear you, but God desires us. And check this out, there's no exceptions. There are no exceptions. God is not predetermined to reject anyone. God loves the whole world. And God's entire creation and all God's creatures. Christ was the atoning sacrifice, the atonement for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the sins of the entire world. You've heard me say this before, and you'll hear me say this over and over again. Jesus did not die for the Christians. He died for the world, amen? And here's the cool thing. There's no obstacle on God's part to anyone's redemption. I'm going to say that again. There is no obstacle on God's part to redemption. That's good news. But how? How does God get a hold of us? How does God make it so that all can be saved? Well, last week in our potluck, we agreed that some of us would go to chapel Tuesday at 10 a.m. And I want to encourage you to go to chapel again this week at Tuesday at 10 a.m. I won't be there. I think I'll be out of town. But try it out. But this person over here, Britt, she gave the message. And I thought, oh my goodness, it's perfect. So Britt, you're it.
Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 10. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you've been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast, for we are what he has made us, created us in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
As Pastor Bill said, my name is Britt. I'm a junior here at CNU, double majoring in religion and church leadership and comparative religion and philosophy. I'm from Park Hills, Missouri, which is an hour south of St. Louis. Very small town, very easy to miss it. I'm a lifelong United Methodist, and if you can't tell by my majors, or if for whatever reason it just went over your head, I am pursuing a call to ordained ministry to become an ordained pastor in the United Methodist Church. Here on campus, I work as the Director of Communications here at Lynn Memorial United Methodist Church, and a campus organization that I'm heavily involved with is the Center for Faith and Service. That's the CMU campus ministry that's ran by Reverend Caleb Kelly. And this morning, to help kick off my sermon, I'm going to start off with some hard questions. How often in our lives do we feel like we are not enough? How often do we feel like we don't qualify for the love of God? How often do we feel like we can never work hard enough to achieve some goal that we strive to attain in our life? To simplify this, let me give an answer that I know some of us are thinking. We all feel like we aren't enough. We all feel like we don't qualify for anything special, especially the love of God. in town, and I had an issue talking with new people and getting to know them, but this particular group of people were different. I wanted them and still want them to like me because they matter a whole lot to someone that I care about. And so through every interaction I had with them, I tried to get them to like me, and I tried to have them see value in me, and to me, in my opinion, I seemed to have failed. They held some opinions that were a little hurtful and hit at some of my greatest insecurities and my greatest fears. And while I was constantly feeling all of this, and I was battling all of this, and I'm still battling it, a reoccurring thought in my head was, am I enough to these people? Or is who I am enough to my friend because of what these people think of me? I've constantly had to keep myself from thinking I have disqualified myself from them seeing any value in me ever. Literally, never could they ever see any value in me. I'm sure that some of us in the room have experienced similar situations and may be still dealing with those situations like myself. For the college students, or actually students in general, maybe we think, am I a good enough student? Am I good enough that these new people in my life want to be my friends? Am I good enough to feel like I belong with this crowd or that crowd? Regardless of where you are in your life right now, I'm pretty sure that most of us can say that at times we do the same thing with our faith. When we talk about disqualifying ourselves and context of our faith, many of us may at one time or another have thoughts similar to these. I don't have enough of a faith life. I don't have the right kind of spiritual gifts. I don't do this, and I don't do that. I've always done this particular type of thing. I can't possibly change what it is that I do. We think that we can't know or experience God without specializing in some form of biblical knowledge or being able to pull this fact or that fact out of our hat. We can't play an active role in a faith community because of how we see our faith and knowledge to be in comparison to that of other people. That can't be further from the truth, though, because we do qualify. We have always qualified. There is nothing that we have done, could do, or will do that will make us, quote-unquote, qualify for us to receive God's love in the form of grace. I know this may seem like a somewhat crazy idea, but let me explain. In Romans chapter 3, verse 24, we can see that the scriptures say we are justified by God's grace as a gift, which means that we do nothing to earn this. It is just with us, always with us. There is never a moment where we haven't been deserving of the grace of God. To help us understand the gravity of this, I did a quick passage search just to see the number of times that the concept of grace and how it works is mentioned in the Bible. 214 times. Grace is mentioned in 214 different passages. The first time grace is mentioned in the Bible after sin has entered the world is the story of Cain and Abel. For a quick refresher, Cain and Abel are the sons of Adam and Eve, the first humans of the earth. Cain, the older sibling, gets jealous of the younger brother Abel because God appreciates the offering that Abel gave more than the offering that Cain provided. In his jealousy, Cain flat out, rock to the head, murders Abel. And when God confronts Cain about his sin, what does God do? Now, keep in mind that this is the same God that created every living thing on earth. The same God that brought light to darkness, brought order to chaos. The same God that is almighty in power and can do anything he desires. Do you know what he does? Once Cain receives the consequence of his actions, God shows him grace by saying, "No one shall harm you. And if they do, they will receive what they have done unto you sevenfold." God pardons and shows unconditional grace to a man who we would have considered to have committed an ultimate sin. Grace didn't leave Cain after he killed his brother. It stayed with him and was still working in his life afterwards. If God does this for Cain, I want all of us to ask the question, why can't God do this to me too? And here's something that I hope isn't a secret, because it shouldn't be a secret. God does. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ, by grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you've been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. In the United Methodist Church, we understand grace to be something that is present, moving and working in our lives. As soon as a baby takes its first breath to the moment a person takes their dying. Grace isn't dependent upon anything that we can do as human beings. It is dependent upon God, who already has given us the gift of grace without us asking for it or even intentionally desiring it. For another instance of God's overwhelmingly abundant grace, the song we sang as our opening hymn is kind of an old hymn. And the hymn focuses all on how God's grace abounds through the ages without fail. Many people that I know say that this is one of the most beautiful hymns that they have ever heard. But the history of the hymn is a little bit darker. Amazing Grace was written by John Newton, who was a slave trader in the British slave trade almost 250 years ago. The hymn was written as a response to a life-altering moment Newton had after he almost died on a voyage back to England. This voyage takes place after his slaver crew had abandoned him and left him to die in West Africa. And once he had survived the voyage back to England, Newton came upon this realization that he had not only experienced great suffering, but brought great suffering to others. And that to other people, it would have been enough to treat him like a monster. But God still saw him as a beloved child, more than deserving of that non-returnable gift of free grace. Grace is never ending and will withstand all of time. No matter the life you have lived, the actions you have taken, the words you have said, the decisions you make, grace is already with you. God's grace is abundant in your life even before you decide to acknowledge its presence. To quote and give a modernized paraphrase of John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, "The grace of God, from which our salvation comes, is free in all and free for all. It is free in all to whom it is given, It does not depend on any power or merit of man, not in any degree, whole or part. So, the next time, or maybe even right now, when we find ourselves in situations that we want to question whether or not we are enough to have God's grace in our lives, we don't belong in a faith community because of this qualification or that qualification. The truth is that we already do, and will always be enough because God's grace abounds. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you once again in thankful adoration for this wonderful day that we get to come and be before you in your presence, God, and worship you. We ask that your Spirit be here moving in our hearts, Lord, make them unhardened so that we can experience your grace and know that no matter what we face in our lives, we are enough. It's in your name we pray, God. Amen.
Amen. Where I come from, we clap when we get a good word. And we're not boasting of Britt, we're boasting and clapping on what God did for you, Britt. So. My hope and prayer is that this sanctuary will be known as a place that is safe. That this sanctuary will be known as a place of grace, where all are welcome. Where all know that God loves them and that we are a people that show that love to all. Can I give an amen? I was going to give you a little testimony about grace and why we named our littlest Grace, but that'll be for another day. Earlier I said that God has no boundaries to God's desire for all of us to experience salvation. That boundary, that wall, is us. Within our denial, our fear. And so that's why it's good to practice a confession and pardon, because it gets us thinking about I can do more as far as opening myself up to God. So please join me in unison. Almighty God, who does freely pardon all who repent and turn to him, now fulfill in every contrite heart the promise of redeeming grace, forgiving all our sins, and cleansing us from an evil conscience. Through the perfect sacrifice of Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news, church. God is slow to anger and full of compassion. God forgives all who humbly repent and trust in his Son as Savior and Lord. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For it is in his mighty and holy name you are forgiven. Amen. Oh, I just remembered the second announcement. So on the 10th of October, we're going to start a new worship series, Spooky Sundays. So tell all your friends, because we're going to talk about ghosts, witches, goblins, Frankenstein, you name it. Come on in. And this will, I'm just going to take a look at what Scripture tells us about all this stuff. How appropriate, right? Because isn't it Halloween, like, during October? So, Adam Hamilton will call this a fishing expedition. So tell your friends. Get them in here so they can hear a word or two about all this spooky stuff. Now is the time where we need to bring our offerings forward. So if you don't have offerings, that's okay. We want to encourage you to still come forward and give yourself as an offering to God. Don't worry, nobody's going to come up here and sacrifice you or anything. That's already been taken care of. Jesus did that for you, amen? That'd be a weird thing, but if we did that, so fortunately we don't. But you can come forward and offer yourself in the way of coming at these prayer rails and praying to God. If you're in need of a personal, private prayer, I'm going to be over here. I'm going to turn the microphone off, and you and I can pray together. You can also bring your prayer requests forward and place those in the baskets as well. Why do we practice offering? Because that's what worship is. That's how it all began. Whenever God would do something amazing and a human being would see it, they would build an altar and put an offering on it and worship God. So let's do this. Please come forward. Give thanks to God. we offer these prayers and gifts as an expression of awe and wonder in who you are, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one who freely gives grace. Amen.
It's amazing what we can do when we know that we are enough for God, that we can be saved, that grace is with us, that he loves us. We can do anything. And so as we go out into the world and prepare to be a witness to that, let us join in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Go, serve the Lord your God, while your hearts are mine.